Good morning. You're listening to Spectrum on 105.9 WJZW Woodbridge, Washington. I'm Thomas Grooms, and joining us this morning, a gentleman who you may be familiar with from Late Night with David Letterman, a guy who's no stranger to 105.9. He's been here, I believe, 6 years ago on Spectrum. He also was here 10 years ago on the Blues Room, and I'm referring to Mr. Anton Fig. Anton, good morning, and welcome back to Spectrum.
Hi, Thomas.
How you doing?
I'm doing great. It's great to see you again.
I don't know if it's a figment of my imagination or if it really came to fruition, but I know you talked to us 6 years ago. You had just released your drumming video.
Right.
And you said, you know, I'm going to make a record.
Well, I did it. It took me the better part of that 6 years, but it finally got done.
And it is incredible. It's called Figments, and you're on a promotional tour right now throughout the Washington area. And I must say, it all starts when you look at your career. Your resume is incredible. Back in 1982, 83, to the David Letterman Show, tuning in. And we saw, a four-piece band?
Right. I joined the show, I think it was 85 or 86, but the four-piece band that was there was Steve Jordan and Hiram Bullock. And that was a great band. And, you know, about 4 years into the show was when I came on board. And it was four-piece then, and now it's evolved into an eight-piece band.
What was the evolution like? I mean, the last time you were in, you were just moving to the new theater. I think we did the Blues Show. You were moving into the Ed Sullivan Theater. But the evolution from the world's most dangerous band into the CBS orchestra, what was that evolution like?
Well, you know, personally, I think that, I mean, Letterman should have inherited the Tonight Show. And so it was kind of strange going off in a way that seemed like he was destined to go in a different direction. But life doesn't always work out that way. So, I mean, they got the theater, you know, is a famous, famous theater. And, you know, the Beatles and Elvis and all of them have been on that stage. So it has a lot of history, and it was beautifully redone. And, you know, you never know if the show is going to fly, even though Letterman's a monstrous talent. You're starting off on a new franchise and a new place. He very quickly established himself and has gone from strength to strength there. And I think at that time they wanted to have a larger band. So originally we had Bernie Worrell playing keyboards, but then they really wanted horns, a horn section and not really an orchestra, but a kind of bigger band. So the band evolved into that.
And now that you are the CBS orchestra, how much input exactly do you have into the pieces that are played?
Well, everyone in the band can make suggestions. You know, Paul is the ultimate, you know, he's the band leader, and he has sort of veto power over everything. But, you know, usually we will play a song, like when a guest walks on, we'll play some music that is apropos to the person's, you know, bodily characteristics or the latest project or movie or whatever. And, you know, the song is associated with them. And so everyone throws out ideas. As far as the break tunes go, I mean, anyone can say, you know, oh, I feel like playing this song now, and Paul will go, okay, fine.
Well, it is an incredible orchestra.
It is.
All of America knows that. All the world knows that. And since you've released Figments, a lot of those people have helped you on this CD.
Right. I've got Paul and Will and Sid and Felicia. And then plus I have, you know, through the Letterman Show, I've gotten to play with a lot of different people and prior to that. But my musical life has been about playing in lots of different kinds of situations, lots of different types of music. So one of my challenges of doing this record was how to make different styles sort of fall under one umbrella and sound like a cohesive package and not just a random collection of songs. And I figured that with my producing and my drumming, that would be enough because there's different singers on every song. And, you know, could have ended up like a hodgepodge, but it didn't at all.
But it is a potpourri when it comes to musical styles, like you mentioned. There's a little bit of everything for everyone on the
CD. Yeah, and I mean, that wasn't done on purpose. It's just, you know, I was born in South Africa, and so there is a South African influence. I did play with Ace and Sebastian Bach and those guys, and I wanted to represent that kind of style. That's a big part of my musical history as well, playing that kind of music. And so it just ended up, but you see, I think that all the music is related to one another. It doesn't feel like a stretch to go from like a world kind of song to like a hard rocking kind of song. It's all the same thing to me.
And speaking of South Africa, you have a very good friend on the CD with you. Blondie Chaplin, and Blondie and Ricky Fitar were discovered, I believe, when they were in the band The Flame over in South Africa by the Beach Boys. Brian Wilson, the Wilson brothers, brought them over to America.
Right.
And the rest is history. And I know you're very happy to have Blondie playing with you.
Right. Well, Blondie was the lead vocals on Sail on Sailor that the Beach Boys did. But what was really special, I mean, I played with Blondie for a long time. We did Paul Butterfield's last record together. And I've been in bands with Blondie for 10, 15 years around New York. We're like really, really good friends, and we play all the time. But what was great was that I got him on a song, and I got Brian Wilson to sing the backgrounds on that song. So, you know, it was like a real good match, because it was like reverberating back to the Sail on Sailor thing.
It is incredible, and he had a kinship with my friend Rick Danko for many, many years.
Yeah,
Blondie
Rick
was part of the Rick Danko band, and has definitely paid dues, and had a great solo album out, a lot of solo albums, actually.
Well, I'm on two of them. The one is hard to find, called Ostrich Man. The other one, The Fragile Thread, has yet to be released, although we've recorded it like over a year ago. But that's a really, really great record. Blondie's a fantastic writer and singer.
And you guys actively gig around New York City all the time.
We do, yeah. I mean, we don't play a lot, but whenever we do, it's a very special thing.
And speaking of Blondie, another guy that I'm thinking of right now is Al Cooper.
Right. Well, I'm actually going to play with him in New York in a couple of weeks. But we were just in Seattle and Portland playing, him, Jimmy Vivino, Mike Merritt, and myself. And, you know, he is a... Well, besides being a piece of work, he's also a piece of history, you know. All the stuff that he's done, the records he's produced, Lynyrd Skynyrd and all that, and those Blood, Sweat and Tears, that first Blood, Sweat and Tears record is a classic, and the Super Sessions record. So it was great to get him on.
He is a genius.
Yeah.
And so is Vivino. I mean, he's got a record
that is
pretty good. He put out a record with that band.
Right.
And he, of course, up in Woodstock with Rick Danko, Jimmy Weider, who was a friend of Sid McGuinness.
Right.
And Jimmy just put out a record. He wants to send his regards to you, by the way.
I'll tell him.
The Jimmy Weider Band. Anton, how can we get a hold of this CD? We're going to play a track from it in a few moments, but how can we pick it up?
Well, it's available. At the moment, it's available only on my website, antonfig.com. And, you know, basically, I did the record. I had this great day job, you know, with the Letterman show, so I was able to do the record without any kind of support. I didn't really try and solicit any record deal or anything like that. I just started on the project by myself, and now that it's done, I'm just selling it on the web. I'm looking into distribution and all that, and the only reason it's not in the stores is because I just haven't sort of completed that cycle. But in the meantime, you can go to the web. There's like tons of more information about me there than I'd even care to admit. You can hear little snippets of the record, and you can purchase it with a credit card. It is a very secure site and all that.
What do you think of what's happening on the internet these days with the downloading of songs? Are you for it? Are you against it?
Well, I don't know. I have mixed feelings. I do think that the artists kind of lose the income that they're supposed to get when you buy the record. And I also think that it kind of starts associating the web with free music as opposed to like a viable place for people to buy music. But at the same time, the big companies that have such a stranglehold on the industry, I think it's really good that there are outlets for people to be able to make their own music and not be dependent on the, you know, the bigger companies in order to be creative. So I think it has a very good effect on the creative aspect of music. But I wish there was a way so that if people spend all this time and energy making something, that they don't then have to give it away for free.
This CD took, what, 3 years, over 3 years?
Yeah. Yeah, it took I had, you know, the Letterman show, but I had to work around it all the time, and each song was sort of, you know, took a while to craft each song. People played individually. We didn't go in the studio and everybody played together. Each part went on by itself, and, you know, I had to try and keep it so that it sounded spontaneous and the people were interacting with one another.
So the new technology has really helped. This is proof positive by listening to this record.
Yeah, I mean, you know, when I said to you 6 years ago I'm going to make a record, one of the things was when they have digital equipment for the home, that was when I wanted to make a record, you know, and you have like affordable equipment, and this record would have cost me hundreds of thousands if I went in the studio, but it was a fraction of that doing it at home, and Yeah, I could never have done it without the technology that's available today.
Yeah, I was rapping with David Sanborn, I guess, in June, and he was telling me he can't wait to get his Pro Tools and Cool Edit in his house, in his basement, so he can put out a new record.
Right.
So this is the thing. This is what's happening.
Yeah, I mean, I'm all for going in a room with a bunch of people and sitting down and playing, like the old-fashioned way, and you just got to play, you know. But this is also a way to do it. And in this case, I would kind of go in the studio and put the drums on with some guide tracks, and then I would bring it home, and I would have people come to the house. I had Richie Haven singing in my bedroom, you know, and it sounds like a studio. You know, it sounds just great.
And he's on one of the tracks, More Than Friends.
Yeah, and he's, you know, sings with that beautiful, rich authority. You know, and he came in, he was so beautiful. He just came in, like, ready to do it. He knew the song, sang it a bunch of times, and left. You know, he was great.
Well, on the new CD, Figments, you have a smooth jazz artist, Chris Bode, with you. Chris has been on Spectrum, as has Jimmy Vivino on Spectrum over the past year. But Chris Bode is on a track, and it's a really nice track. It's jazzy.
Well, it's reminiscent to me of like a Cape Town, you know, Cape Town, South Africa, sort of Cape Town melody. And I have Tony Cedras playing keyboards. He plays with in Paul Simon's Graceland band, you know, and he's from Cape Town. Chris Mundoki on upright bass, and Chris played with Trela Gertu. He's a real great jazz bass player. And Andy Schnitzer's on sax. And Chris Bode. And I was in a band in New York with Chris Mundoki, Andy Schnitzer, and Chris Bode. We played like every Tuesday night for about a year in New York.
Sure, Schnitzer went out with the Stones. He was a Stones horn man.
Yeah.
And I believe Blondie is going out with the Stones.
He's out with them now, yeah. They're rehearsing. He just called me from wherever they are. And it's a small world. You know, that's one thing. I've got about 45 different musicians on here, but they're all interlinked with, you know, with one another.
Well, it's a beautiful piece, and you wrote it.
Yeah.
And it's called?
It's called Tears.
Well, why don't we set that up right now and play it?
Sure. Well, hi, this is Anton Fig. We're going to play a song from my new CD, Figments, available at antonfig.com. It's a song reminiscent of Cape Town, South Africa. It's called Tears on Smooth Jazz 105.9. Hi, this is Anton Fig. We just heard a song called Tears from my CD, Figments. You're listening to Spectrum, Smooth Jazz 105.9.
With us this morning, Anton Fig, drummer from the CBS Orchestra, and you know him from Late Night with David Letterman, and he has just released a brand new CD, Figments, and if you want more information about it, you can log on to antonfig.com.
Right.
And all the info is there. Your career, you started on the Letterman show, what year, 1980?
I think it was 85. Either 85 or 86, but somewhere around there.
And you were filling in for Steve Jordan. You told me that. You were filling in for Steve. He came back for a little while, then he went away and you had a gig.
Right. I mean, it was freaky because I'd always wanted to sub on the show, and I'd said to Paul, you know, give me a chance to sub, and it just seemed like they never called me. And then one day Paul called, said Steve's going to be away and for a week and, you know, come and do a rehearsal. And then I did the rehearsal. He said, well, actually, Steve's going to be away for 2 weeks. Can you do the 2 weeks? Steve came back, and then I filled in another couple of days. But it was almost within a month of my first subbing on the show that I had the job. And I don't know what happened. You know, Steve left, or, you know, I don't know what the story was, but it was just incredible timing.
Well, that, of course, is your claim to fame. But we love you here in Washington because you worked with a legendary cat named Link Wray, and that's how I met you when you were working with Link Wray and Robert Gordon back in the 70s.
Right.
How did that come about, Anton?
Let's see, I moved to New York, and I'd been in Boston at the New England Conservatory, and I was, like, very involved in jazz, and I came down to New York, and for about a year, this was in 76, 77, somewhere around there, I was trying to sit in at the clubs, and I saw all these jazz guys going, you've got to get back to your roots, and I thought, well, when I grew up in Cape Town, I used to play a lot of rock, so I auditioned for a rock band that was on CBS, called Topaz, that had Billy Cross and Rob Stoner. I don't know if you know that.
They played with Dylan.
Right. So Howie Wyeth was their drummer, and he went to play with Dylan, so I got that gig. And they all knew Robert Gordon. They introduced me to Robert Gordon. Oh, no, maybe Howie was playing with Robert Gordon, and then he went off to the Dylan gig, so I got that gig.
Yeah, and Robert, of course, from Maryland also, so we love him too.
Yeah. Actually, I just spoke to him the other day. I hadn't spoken to him in a long time.
Anton, when did you start writing songs? When did you decide you wanted to be a composer?
Well, I just kind of, you know, actually I was in a band called Spider. And they encouraged us to write a lot. And we had some great writers in the band, like Holly Knight, who ended up, you know, went on to write Better Be Good to Me for Tina Turner and a bunch of Pat Benatar hits and some other Tina Turner songs. But so I just started writing just because that's what, you know, we were supposed to do. We all had to come up with stuff. And then I write a few songs on my own, but I also like collaborating with other people, coming up with some ideas and then maybe getting together with someone else and they, you know, help me with the words or with some melody or whatever. But, you know, I'm really happy on my record. The songs came out really, really nicely and I'm very happy. I don't sit down and write every day. I'm not a prolific writer, but I like to kind of mess around with the synths or the guitars and come up with some ideas.
You're listening to Spectrum on 105.9 WJZW. Our guest this morning, Anton Fig from The Late Night Show. And our focus this morning, his brand new CD, Figments. And of course, you were talking about playing with Chris Botti and David, part of the Paul Butterfield Blues Band back in the late 60s. Mm-hmm. I had to send him all that Butterfield stuff that was on record that he doesn't have for his Pro Tools up in New York. But he was in the band. You became friends with Paul Butterfield. You told me the story where before he passed on, he got $60 from you.
Yeah, lying on his back in the hospital bed. I mean, he was a master at that. But, you know, he was also like an incredible band leader. I mean, incredible. He was like so nice to work for. And he was very definitive and he was strong. And he played with conviction and he was really great. I mean, I really learned a lot playing with him.
You have played with David on the show.
Right.
That was an experience, wasn't it?
Yeah, Sanborn is incredible. He's amazing. And actually, I just listened to, I have a tape of when Miles Davis was on the Letterman show and it was Miles, Sanborn, Marcus Miller, and then Will, Paul, and myself, and Sid. And it was great. It was great just playing with them. And when you hear that recording, although you can't really get it, it's just, to me, it just sounds like classic Miles, and Sanborn plays fantastically on it.
I know it was a high point in your career because he paid you a compliment that you told me about.
Yeah. Miles. Yeah, he said to me, you got a good feel for them drums, and you know, at that point, I just said, I didn't want to hear any ands or buts or anything like that. Got out of the room as soon as I could, but it was really nice of him. It's something I've carried with me and built upon, you know, ever since then.
Also on the record, you have Chip Taylor, a guy who people might not know, wrote Wild Thing.
Right, Angel of the Morning.
Merrily Rush.
Can't Let Go.
That's right.
And a bunch of others.
How'd you get him to work with you?
Well, I've actually been friends with Chip for years. I mean, like, really a long time. And we've written many songs together, and I just actually played on his new record. He has a new record out as well. And he's asked me to play with him at the Bottom Line in a couple of weeks, also in New York. But this was a song we'd written a while ago, and it came out really beautifully, and I wanted to include it on the record.
What's the New York music scene like today in 2002?
Well, you know, if you go down to the Lower East Side, there's some really good guys coming up, you know, sort of jazzy guys, fantastic musicians, young guys. There's a few clubs where they play live drum and bass kind of stuff, which is pretty nice. There are a few enclaves of things like, you know, I was playing at this place, the Metropolitan. We decided to play there for 3 weeks on a Tuesday night. We ended up playing there for 2 years every Tuesday night, and the place is still going strong. They just had their fifth anniversary, and it's where someone can just walk in and listen to great music, and it's a sort of bar and restaurant. There seems to be quite a bit of live music around in the city where you can play. You know, I'm happy to say people still go out and listen.
But the point that I was making is that you definitely have paid dues, because before you got the gig on the Letterman show, you were playing in dives, roadhouses,
you know,
everywhere with Link.
Well, I do that for the music. I don't really care if it's a dive or whatever it is, if the musicians are great. And I still go, I still take my drums in a cab and go down and play the $40 gig and set them up myself, play to all hours if I'm playing with people that I want to play with, because You know, it's all well and good to have the great gig, and that's fantastic, but, you know, you got to keep playing and keep, you know what I mean?
Just sure.
Keep working all the time.
I sit at home on the weekends a lot of times and watch the video of you and Mick Fleetwood playing. We brought you in 6 years ago. You and Mick had your little drum battle.
Right.
What a night that was.
Yeah,
that was a
fun.
Great club, and that was musical history.
That's not still open, that place, is it?
No, Mick went back to L.A.
Yeah.
And I saw him when Fleetwood Mac came through. He called me, and I went to the gig, and he thanked us for everything that we've done.
Yeah.
You know, Smooth Jazz 105.9, we brought Philippe Sace there. We had a lot of good acts there.
Yeah.
And he wanted, you know, he loved the music, just like you. He just wanted to drum, and it's sad that it closed, but it was definitely musical history.
Yeah.
John Van Horn played with you, who was a member of Link's band. Whatever happened to the lost John Van Horn tapes?
I don't know. Hopefully they'll be found soon.
But you did play with him. You came down and did a little recording at Q Studio,
right.
I remember, over the years. What's ahead for Anton Fig in 2003, 2004?
Well, you know, I want to kind of get this record out there because the response that I've been getting from the people that have heard it has been overwhelmingly positive. So my, you know, my project is to get that out there. But I'm also playing in a few different bands. I'm playing with this young guy, Oz Noy. He's a fantastic guitarist. I just did some live recording with him. I'm playing with a band called the South African All-Stars. That's some of the guys from South Africa that are in Paul Simon's band. I started to write a couple of new songs with Blondie. You know, that in a way that once I did this record and I kind of cleared my mind of this collection of songs, it opens the way up for starting new ideas and new things. So, you know, I just want to keep playing. I just want to get better as a musician, better as a drummer, and just keep going.
You're listening to Spectrum on 105.9 WJZW. Our guest this morning, Anton Fig, drummer with the CBS Orchestra, and he's from, of course, the CBS Late Night Show with David Letterman, and he has a brand new CD out called Figments, which is available.
Yeah, the record's available at AntonFig.com, and you can just go there and put in the credit card, and or if you send an email, I'll be happy to sign it to you, too.
I know that you're also happy about Bruce. Springsteen's making a comeback, very strong. He was with you guys for, what, a week?
He was he did the show, the Thursday and Friday show.
Mm-hmm.
And I have to say that it sounded incredible. We didn't get to play with him. He brought his band. But we did play with them. I played with him on a few occasions. And I actually went up to meet him afterwards. And he reminded me that I'd played with him at the Garden and what a great time he'd had. But he also did the last show at NBC that Letterman did. And you know, playing with a guy like that is great. There's certain guys like him and James Brown, and they play with such commitment that they're conducting with their body, and it's very, very easy to play with them because they just are so defined in what they do. And all you got to do is just watch them and go along, and you can't go wrong. They're so powerful.
You also did Bob Dylan's 30th anniversary for Columbia Records. That was fantastic.
That was a great concert, and I got to back up just about everyone on that. It was Jim Keltner and myself on drums, and then Booker T and Duck.
Duck was on
Duck
bass.
And Steve. I got Duck on my record.
Yeah, sure, I know. Yeah. It was real cool.
And that was a fabulous concert. And then, you know, more recently, I did the concert for New York, the 9/11 concert for New York, and that was also... you know, it was wonderful to see the whole middle section in the front of, there must be, I don't know how many thousand people, 5,000 people, was reserved all for the cops and the firemen and the people that were really on the front lines. And this was one of the first nights where they kind of went out for a celebration since the event. And it was wonderful to see that. And, I mean, I got to play with Mick Jagger and Keith Richards together, which was amazing. And then I would have to switch gears and play with James Taylor and then switch gears again and play with Buddy Guy and Eric Clapton. So, you know, I got to play. I felt guilty because I was having such an amazing time up there fulfilling all these fantasies.
But you're used to having fun and playing
it
hard.
It was great. I mean, it was great. The Garden, it felt like a very small little intimate club. It didn't feel like a big place at all.
Well, on behalf of everyone here in the Washington, D.C. area, we want to thank you for that 9/11 concert. I know it's going to still take time to heal the wound. But not to bring up anything negative, what was going through your mind on 9/11?
Well, I think I was stunned. You know, it was a beautiful week, and I was scheduled to go out of town to the beach. It was the Letterman show happened to be off, and when that happened, I just said, "There's no way I can't leave town," you know. And so I went up onto the roof of my building, and I could see the smoke and all the stuff. And I'd actually woke up in the morning and had gotten a call from South Africa. And someone said, "Anton, are you okay?" And I said, "Why?" They said, "Turn on your TV," you know. And I turned on the TV, and I saw one of the buildings fall. And so the first thing we did was we went and, you know, tried to find out what we could buy and supplies and all this kind of stuff. We went and bought food and plates and, you know, knives and forks and whatever we could do, what we thought that they would need, and sent, you know, went to the drop-off areas to try and help. And we did this about three times, and then kind of went around to various fire stations and just to pay our respects. And it was... New York changed, you know, that week. I mean, people were different. And you know, people did kind of, after a little while, start going back. People started to honk their horns and scream at each other. But for a while, it was one very bonded community. You know, I mean, unfortunately for the wrong reasons. But, you know, so I just stayed in town. I remember it was a beautiful, beautiful week. You know, it was, and I thought, how terrible. It's like this beautiful weather and this terrible tragedy going on.
Well, we just want you to know that you've been in our prayers, everyone in New York, as well as our ABC family up there, our headquarters. We were thinking about you. Mm-hmm. And I'm just glad that everyone's all right. And it was a moving show when Letterman signed back on.
Yeah, that show was unbelievable. Now, on the Sunday night before, I was at a fire station and I ran into the producer of the show. And he said, you know, we're going to go back on tomorrow. Dave's going to do a show. We don't know what we're going to do, but we're going to go back on. And no one knew. You know, Dave was the first to go back. And no one knew what we were going to do or what to do. They established that we weren't going to play the theme song at the beginning. And that Dave was going to talk. But, you know, there was... He had a real conflict of, like, how could he do a show? And what element of humor can you put in? And how serious, you know... So that was an amazing time, and I think at that point Letterman proved himself to be much more than just a talk show host, but like a sort of unofficial spokesman of a generation, and really, I think, elevated between that and the show he did after he was ill, really elevated his status, you know, as a personality. You know, he became much more.
Oh,
you know.
Well, we thank you, and I know the show is responsible for getting America back on track and bonding America, mm-hmm. and you can definitely be proud of that fact. With us this morning, Anton Fig from CBS Late Night. Our focus is his brand new CD entitled Figments, which is available online at www.antonfig.com.
Right.
You'll find out all the information there. As we move again into 2003, do you think the music business will change in any way, any more than it has?
Well, you know, it feels to me like it's gotten very locked in, you know, the way that the bigger companies bought up all the small ones and have so much control. But I think with the equipment and all this digital stuff for the home, I think it's going to allow people to make music. And I think some interesting music is somehow going to slip through the cracks and people are going to hear about it. I mean, usually that's what happens. When something new happens, it's because some accident happened and it slipped through and, you know, the public suddenly went for it. You know, no one thought it was going to work kind of thing. Usually when people think it's going to work, it doesn't mean that it does.
That's why I have to throw away all my Macarena records.
Yeah.
You're listening to Spectrum on 105.9 WJZW Woodbridge, Washington. Our guest this morning has been drummer Anton Fig from the CBS Orchestra and Late Night with David Letterman. Would you like to add anything in conclusion about your new record or future projects before we wrap up?
Well, all I can say is that it's not easy for me to kind of talk about myself and say that something that I did is good. I've lived with this record for must be 4 years now, and I listened to it the other day, and I hadn't heard it for a while, and I have to say that it still sounds really good to me. And that's a very rare thing for me to say, so I really do mean it from my heart that it's worth listening to.
Anton, best of luck with your brand new record, Figments.
Thanks.
I know it'll do well. Success will crown your efforts. Thank you for coming in and continuing our friendship.
Thank you, Thomas, for having me. It's great to see you.
And I hope that you'll come back again when you're through Washington.
Anytime.
All right.
Yeah.
Anton Fig, from the CBS Orchestra.
Broadcasting from our nation's capital.
Smooth Jazz 105.9.
This is WJZW Woodbridge, an ABC radio station.